Hi, my name is Danielle King. I'm the Director of Cultural Programs at Lower Manhattan Cultural Council. So this session is devoted to the idea that making and then sharing theater has two foundational needs, one being time and one being space. So the plan for the next 45 minutes, an hour, is to share a little research into creative development space and how theater makers in NYC are utilizing those spaces, and then hopefully have an active conversation with you about how that does or doesn't reinforce your own experiences or your own knowledge of this network, and what questions it could prompt for future further investigation into this, because this is like a very precursory kind of, let's see how much data we can get compiled quickly and then see what we learn from it to move forward potentially to something deeper. So thanks for joining me. First I want to talk a little bit about my connection to this and investment in this topic. So I'm really happy that Andrew invited me here to Prelude, particularly because this year celebrates the maker, and the word theater maker has a very personal connection for me in my background as a theater maker, and now as someone who's devoted to bringing their time and their passions to making space for artists and facilitating the creative development of their work. And I also think this festival and the ability to focus on kind of the making of things is so, gives us this rare opportunity to come together and share knowledge and experience about making work. I find that we all tend to be busy working with or alongside each other on our different tracks of projects, and we're really aware of our community and the network that we're working within, but we don't often have the time or the space to talk about what it's like for all of us, and how do we build our networks, and how can we lean on each other and utilize each other's networks and each other's experiences. So I feel like this is a really nice moment to be able to come together and do that in a small way. And at LMCC, in my role there, I really have to understand the realities of how artists are working, how work is being made, which is changing constantly, and how to leverage our existing resources and networks, or identify new networks and resources in which to support that creative development. So much of how LMCC empowers artists is about creating space, making space for artists to then go on and make their work. So, in talking to Andrew about Prelude, we felt it was really important to have a conversation about space, which I and LMCC is very invested in, and that it would be really interesting and beneficial to pool our knowledge about how we identify and use space for development and see what that looks like. So, oh, I just completely forgot about an introduction slide. That was my intro. So what did we do? And all of these photos actually are photos from residencies that LMCC has supported in various spaces, a lot of which is totally donated empty commercial office space in Lower Manhattan. Therefore, it looks unlike most rehearsal spaces. So what did we do? So we thought we would develop a really quick, really dirty survey to get some initial data on the basics of space in NYC. So what is the space, where is the space, and how are people accessing it? And then we developed that really quickly. We sent it to a list of Prelude artists and also a little bit on social media. So we kind of used the Prelude framework as the framework for this preliminary research. We got 91 responses in a really short amount of time, which was great. And from there, we went to look at the data. So here's what we found. So the first thing, thank you. is, we wanted to understand who is completing the survey and contributing their experience to this research. We really hope to capture the feedback of a large spectrum, a range of Prelude artists in terms of how long everyone had been making work in New York City. So this shows our 91 respondents and how they've identified how many years they've been making work in New York City. So you can see it's really heavily tilted towards, the respondents were heavily tilted towards people who had been working in New York City to make work for over a decade. I think if Andrew were here, he would want to have like a whole conversation about what this means in terms of the larger field, and are we pricing out artists? Is Prelude not bringing in emerging art? Like all of those things. We're not going to talk about those things today, but it's good to kind of look at this and acknowledge who has contributed to this information. Yeah. And also, at any time, if people have questions, just shout. Okay. And that kind of how long people have been making work will be a little bit of a framework for how we view the other data. So it's good to keep that in mind. Oh, come on. Okay. You can't quite see. Okay, it's missing some of the data. But so the other thing we wanted to make sure we were paying attention to is time. How much time, the time that is needed to develop a work. So, you know, every project and every process is different. So acknowledging that, you know, we ask kind of on average, how long do you develop a project over a period of just a year, or multiple years, over many, many years? And maybe unsurprisingly, and the numbers are missing from the bottom, but I'll show you. So that peak right there is about 1 to 2 years of development time. So it does reflect a range. It goes anywhere from like 0 to 1 years to, I think the most we had was maybe like 5 to 10 years. But there's a kind of nexus around development over 1 to 2 years. And this, again, the strata signify the respondents who have been, how long they've been making work in New York City, right? It's also interesting, we did also ask about, aside from kind of a development timeline, when you're in a creative development space, about how often, how many hours a week are you utilizing the space? Again, got a huge range of things from like 1 hour to like 100 hours. But there seemed to be some sort of consensus around like 20 hours a week is what people were saying. So, I'm gonna get the hang of this about. Okay, so when we're talking about creative development space, we're talking about a lot of different kinds of space, and not all space is equal, not all space is the same. Spaces come with all sorts of conditions and factors. And characteristics, and each artist's practice is very different and requires different things, and each project development cycle is very different and requires different things. But can we start to make, can we start to say what matters most in general about creative development space, aside from cost? Putting cost aside for a minute. So we asked a question of, you know, what matters most to you. You can pick up to 3 of these responses, and also there was like an opportunity to write in other and identify other things that were important. So this is the top responses, and I'll note that so the top 3 being proximity, location, which is something I think we can talk about later as we see the visualization of these creative development space networks, because we didn't necessarily ask you proximity or location to what or to where, but we know now location is a factor. Accessibility, room design, then we see of less importance, at least to this respondent group, technology, exclusive use, 24 access, safety and ethics, which also seem a little surprising. We want all our spaces to be safe, so I wonder how people's experiences have affected them actually deprioritizing safety or ethics. And then storage actually was a write-in, it was an other. And I think that if maybe we had put storage in as one of the pre-selected options, we would have gotten a lot more traction there. Because at least in my experience, that ability to have dedicated space where you're storing things over and over every day, I think is not something to, it's definitely something that people consider. So then we get to the cost question. So cost is always a factor, obviously, in making work. And without getting too deeply into the topic of finances, we did want to just understand, you know, recognize that not all development is happening in residencies or in free access to free spaces. So how often are people paying for space? So the stretch starts to answer that question, at least for this particular pool of respondents. And it shows the frequency of paying for space, none of the time, some of the time, most of the time, all of the time, in relation to how long, again, respondents have been making work in New York City. So if you, and you, it's kind of dark, but you see the first bucket is people who have been making work in New York City from 0 to 2 years, then 3 to 5 years, 6 to 10 years, 10 to 20, and then 20 plus years. Interestingly, the only subset that picked that they were paying for space all the time was the 20 plus years group. But so what you start to see is like a slope, an increased slope of free access to space as you get up to like making work for 5 to 6 years. And then there's like a steep decrease. Why is that? Things that Andrew and I have thought about is maybe it starts to reflect the networks that people build and the traction they start to gain as they're working in New York City and developing work. And that you might get around to like a particular project or a career stage after so many years in the city. And then maybe as you reach a threshold of making work over 5 years or your company or your infrastructure or your project needs become really specific or detailed, and or your schedule becomes really kind of specific and it requires paying for space more of the time. Maybe it's your own space, maybe it's a rented space, it's a specific kind of space or a specific location. It's just one kind of thing that we thought maybe might explain this. But again, we would have to look further to really understand what that trend is all about. Okay, this is maybe my favorite part. I should have done a big reveal. So now we get to the moment where we can really start to visualize this network that we've been talking about. We've been talking about creative development in very dry, quantitative ways up until this moment, hopefully. So we asked every respondent on this survey to list, as best as they can remember, every space they have used for creative development in New York City. And so we got this word cloud. So if you take a minute to look at it, because it's really dense, you see spaces that we all are very familiar with, Abrams Art Center, you see La Mama, you see Art NY as being super popular and having a lot of overlap of respondents, which was surprising to me. You see LMCC, not to point us out, but you see it there. You see the public. You see things like My Apartment being really having a lot of consensus, a lot of overlap, which I find so fascinating. And I wonder what that means. Like, does that mean people are writing in their apartments? Does it mean they're actually building work on people in their apartments? Are they rehearsing in their apartments? I'd love to like dive into that more, and all of these to some extent. You also see places, if I can find an example, that aren't really, they're closed or they don't exist anymore. I think Joyce Soho is on here somewhere. Anyway, so when I look at this, I think all those things, and I think, oh my gosh, how amazing and extraordinary that New York City is this home for so much creative development, that we have all of these spaces that we can utilize, that we can consider homes for making work, testing out ideas. And then on the flip side, I think how maddening and frustrating for someone who is making work, and overwhelming, because probably more often than not, you're using one or probably a handful of these spaces every time you're creating one project. So just the logistics of that and the scheduling of that and the bringing your collaborators to those places is kind of the dark side of the administrative burden of making work, right? And I think you start to see that here. The other thing, the other way to look at this, does anyone have any thoughts about this word cloud before we can go back to it when we start talking, but anything that reaches out, it like sticks out at you?
Well, I just think about the, like, if it takes 1 to 2 years to make something, how many places are you at in the 1 to 2 years?
Yeah, you know, exactly. Yeah, so like doing that sort of mapping, which we didn't do, would be really fascinating. And again, this also isn't taking into account presentation spaces either. So.
Oh yeah, and then like, our New York serves so many artists and doesn't, you know, like we're, you know,
right.
Not always super tiny, but.
And they all have different ways of accessing their space. Some are through residencies. Some are in membership. Some, you know, so there's all of those different things to navigate through as you're trying to create work in the city. Okay, the other way I want to show this network is geographically. So you can see it not only by the sheer volume of the places, of what the places are and what areas, how much overlap respondents have, but by the location of these places. So this is a heat map made via Google Maps, so somewhat crudely, and it's a little hard to see. Where all these spaces are, and what areas have some density or intensity in creative activity as translated through identifying spaces for creative development in those particular neighborhoods. So it's maybe kind of predictable. You know, the Village has a very high intensity. Midtown gets a little red spot there too. There's some points of intensity in Brooklyn. There's like a teeny tiny bit up by Columbia. A little bit in Queens. You know, it's fairly, yeah, it's maybe what it's what you would imagine, maybe it's not. I'd be curious to know that. But what it makes me think about is going back a little bit to that, what attributes of a space matter most to you, and the idea that proximity or location was listed as the top one. And we didn't quite ask, we weren't really specific about proximity to what or what kind of location. So is this proximity to where people live? I don't think all of us live in Midtown Manhattan, so I'm inclined to say no. Is it about where is most convenient for collaborators to come to? Is it proximity to the actual presentation space? Is it proximity to something else kind of like not artistically relevant entirely, like, oh, my kid's school or, you know, my day job or whatever that is? That would be kind of our next step is like to peel back those layers a little bit as well. So now we've just gone through a bunch of dry quantitative data, and I'm wondering how looking at all of this and your own experiences of actually making work, how does it feel? Does it Does anyone want to go back to a particular slide and look at it more?
I was interested in the data about the people who've been working 20 or more. So the artists who've been working for 20 plus years, were the only people that said that there was a group that said they always pay for work.
I know.
And I wonder if that's because they were able to find space 10, 15 years ago that's like rent stabilized, that works.
Right.
And they're like, I am never letting go. You know? Right. And so it's interesting because payment isn't necessarily a bad thing. I mean, it might actually reflect a level of stability. It might reflect that you've finally found a space that really works. You know what I mean?
Totally.
Rather than, you know, the word cloud, which suggests like this, you know, you're always searching. So I just thought that was kind of maybe an interesting way to think about paying as not always a negative.
I think that's really great. I think it's very easy for us to get into like the burden of the financial burden of making work, and that there is something empowering about, well, if you're paying for your space, maybe you are an owner, you own the space. Like maybe it's your space. And then maybe you can provide that resource to other artists. And then you're contributing to the network of which you are a part of. Yeah, that would be super exciting to interview those people who said that and see why they pay for space. What's important to them? Up there. I'm gonna go back to the word club because I just really like it.
Yeah, I guess I was thinking about the relationship between affordability and hassle. And that's like kind of the background factor that was sort of implied by the data but didn't quite show up on that chart. Because the cheap spaces in New York, you have to book 2 months ahead, which becomes profoundly impractical as you move along in your career. And like your collaborators get busier and busier. So I thought that kind of might have been a self factor in that distribution chart, because when you're first starting out, the cost is overwhelmingly maybe the most important thing.
Mm-hmm.
But then as you go on, the cheaper spaces or the free spaces require huge amounts of time, energy, and planning to actually access.
Right.
So as soon as you have some funding, that's kind of the first thing. You think, okay, finally I can schedule my rehearsal 2 weeks ahead because I can afford to book the space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the flexibility required kind of earlier in your career where, you know, you're rehearsing at night, you're rehearsing in the morning, you're rehearsing between your day jobs. Yeah. That makes total sense. What else?
One of the things I think is interesting, which definitely feels familiar to me about the way that we're organized as an industry, as a sector, is that there are 91 respondents, but there are way more than 91 spaces. And that seems to suggest that maybe, in fact, there is enough space to a certain degree, but the way in which people are forced to make work, the way we organize making works to work amongst ourselves, the way we want to advance more quickly than maybe we're ready to artistically or professionally, makes a mess of things. Now, this to me is just like a mess. What a mess, you know? And what would it feel like if instead of it being this mad free-for-all that we all participate in, what would it be like if we found more permanent relationships to space that best suited certain organizations for a certain amount of time? What would that look like? How would that feel? Would that be better? Would that be worse? My feeling is that it would be much, much better, but that we're really, for whatever reason, stubbornly refusing to leave our castles. You know, we're all Castellismo-y people. And I think one of the interesting things about this crowd is that, as with most arts admin things, it's mostly women, of course, who are actually thinking about what the hell the problems are. And leaving their castles to be with other people and talk about what we're doing on this planet together. And so I think that to me is indicative of also the competitive nature of what we're doing. Like, instead instead of just sitting down and talking about how we might divvy up some of these spaces together, we're like, well, I'm going to call my person at La Mama and farm my 6 hours this week for free and screw everybody else, you know? So that, it mirrors that situation for me a lot, that what could it look like if we actually sat down and said, how many companies are there? How many spaces are there? What do you need? How can we divvy this up in a more permanent way?
Well, yeah, and that goes back exactly to this kind of why I'm so excited to be in the room here right now, because we're all navigating these networks together. We're all moving through them. We're using them in different ways. We have our different contacts and our different methods, but we all aren't sitting together every once in a while in a big group to say, how's that going for you? How are you doing that? Oh, how could we, like, how can we help each other? How can we leverage what each other is doing? Because it so often feels like a competition. And it's not.
There's no prize.
Right. I mean, the prize is making sure that art happens in the world, and we maintain a level of vibrancy in New York City that makes that for everyone, right?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, lots of things just happened.
Hi. I'm trying to figure out who's in the room. I don't know what I'm going to try to be as anonymous about this as possible, but it's my own personal gripe. Many years ago, I'm actually originally a fiction writer, and someone was interested in a short story of mine and wanted me to turn it into other dramatic writing sort of through the back door. And one of the first productions I had put up in New York, I just sort of found this person who was who directed something, and he through his school, he knew certain people. This was years, many years ago. And I ended up getting free rehearsal space and a production in one of the really great theaters on the Lower East Side at the time. And that was all splendid. And the guy who ran these theaters was very loosey-goosey about who was coming in and out, as far as, you know, it was very relaxed. And the spaces were lovely. And then a very famous trio of musicians sort of wandered into my rehearsals while I was working and observed my play and got the script and walked out with it and made a fortune on Broadway. And the reason I'm sharing this is that's the prize, but that's not the prize that anyone in these situations talks about. And so I was completely unaware that that was even possible. Clearly in the abstract I was aware, but it never dawned on me that something like that would happen to me. And I think that that is why people are so, I think that's the real reason why people are so cautious about sharing, because really, people are trying to protect their work. That's just something I would like to add. I'm not actually like that myself, which is of course why I got taken, but you know, anyway, just something to, it's unbelievable, but it did happen. So,
that's a terrible story, and I'm sorry. What it brings up for me is this idea that, okay, so something else, and maybe this speaks to that safety and ethics, two things that weren't highly selected by respondents, of that we also have to make sure that these creative development spaces are welcoming, but also that, like, we're all respectful of each other, you know, that everyone's coming into these spaces with profound respect for each other, each other's practice, each other's work, which sounds like that maybe it's not what happened in that situation, you know? So there's...
There were very high-level people involved, too. I mean, like, really high-level people who are still professionally active.
Yeah.
So those people are the people who were really more you know, I mean, the people sort of working at my level, I think most of them didn't even know what was happening. It was just, but it's just something to talk about as far as safeguard. You know, I think that is actually a bigger issue than most people might realize. Because there's a lot of money to be made.
Sure.
They made $50 million in their last check.
So how do we make spaces that don't breed that sort of competition, breed that sort of, you know, a lot of, just to bring LMCC into this a little bit, you know, a lot of what we talk about when, in our department, when we're talking about residencies and what kind of spaces we want to create for our artists, we believe strongly in cohort development. We believe really strongly in making sure that the people that are going to be in those shared spaces are going to benefit from each other being in those spaces, that they're going to be generous, that they're going to be eager to learn about each other and their process, and sometimes, you know, with no kind of expectation of like, oh, you must go like collaborate with that person down the line, although sometimes that does happen. So I think it's a really good point to make that we're talking about very like tangible, solid things here when we talk about what matters about space, like obviously the space and how large it is and what it has and how you access it and how much it costs and if there's a piano in there, if there's a dance floor. But then there's this whole other thing of like, what is the kind of culture, the feeling around being in those spaces? Are they spaces that make you want to work? Are they spaces that like kill creativity? You know, like, and I think that that is where like safety and ethics and stuff like that plays a role.
The vibe of the space is a pretty high indicator that didn't make it onto that list in a form that I would have recognized if I had been filling out the survey. But so, like looking at some of the spaces up there, some of them are very artist-friendly and some of them are more places that are just trying to make money. Mm-hmm. And there is definitely a relationship between like how much you would want to rehearse there and like the kind of orientation of the space.
And then that makes me want to kind of dig into, okay, so can we divide all of these spaces kind of along the lines that you're saying, like there's space and then what else do they provide or what kind of vibe do they have or what are the attributes, maybe less tangible of them, and then why would you access that space for a particular reason, you know, as some portion of your creative development, or would you prefer to just be in these kind of spaces? And then what could we do to make those kind of spaces more like these kind of spaces? I think it would be a worthy investigation, I think, further. Maddie.
Sort of going off of that, I'd be really curious to see as the next step in this exploration more information about what sort of sub-communities in downtown Creative Makers happen to like circulate in what particular spaces, like who's developing work at Art NY and what are the other spaces that those groups are using and how often, and starting to look at the types of work that have these different spaces as their like nexuses of creative, like positive places to start developing things, and starting to think about the way that different levels or different types of space facilitate the creation of different types of work and support different types of communities, and what kinds of different artists are having an opportunity to meet each other because they share spaces, and what artists never encounter each other or aren't influenced by each other's work at all because they're never sharing the same creative spaces.
Yeah. I think we think about that a lot too. I think it's particularly hard with people who make time-based work, right? Because you're bringing your collaborators into a room and you're shutting the door, and you've got your time in there, and then you leave. And so, the ability, one of the things you were saying is like the ability to kind of create that sort of like cohort and feeling of community in those types of spaces. You might not actually know who else is in there. You may never cross paths with them. And certainly there are spaces that are more conducive to certain types of work, and to map that out, especially as at least my work and my interests become in supporting artists who are boundary blurring and multidisciplinary, which I think is kind of the way we're all heading in anyway with the internet and with, you know, all the ways of different ways of production and consumption. There'd be, interesting to track that. Andrew.
I just want to follow up on your question because I think you're right, and I don't know how to index that. Because I think all we keep coming into with even these conversations in Prelude is that we can't define by genre. So how else do you define those communities? Because I think you're totally right. So how would a future study create those associations between communities and where they make work so that it isn't just about space, but it's about space and its relationship to, let's say, self-selecting communities? What are those criteria that we need to be capturing so we can understand how space is used by the people, not just how space exists?
I was kind of thinking about that, Andrew, with respect to, I think, digging in deeper to that question of what people mean by proximity. Because I wonder if some of that is proximity to other kinds of venues, proximity to other kinds of artists, proximity to bars and cafes, so that when you're done with rehearsal, you don't just leave because you're in the middle of, you know, nowhere, but there are places to go to continue the conversation. Those kind of trying to dig in a little deeper to what people mean by proximity, because it may not be exactly like what you were saying. It may not be as kind of logistics or transportation or subway. It might be some of these softer but really important kind of elements. And then the other thing, we were talking about it before your presentation, you know, these are spaces that are really about, I think, oftentimes, although not exclusively, once there's a work in a group of people, but what are the kind of pre-spaces? The spaces, you know, parks, coffee shops, bars, like all those other things where actually the initial ideas percolate or when people are writing on their own or things along those lines. And where, you know, where do we make room for that, those kinds of encounters? Because those kind of spaces facilitate particular kinds encounters, but there are all these encounters that happen before them. And is New York a space that really allows that, or are issues like gentrification and cost some of the reasons that those pre-conversations that might lead to different kinds of work simply don't happen, and then it just continues, you know, but if you never make contact at the start, you're not going to later. So those are just some of the things I was thinking.
I think that's great. I think having, it gets much harder to kind of map out, obviously, but like creative development doesn't just stop when you walk out of the rehearsal room or you walk out of your studio. You know, you are constantly, we're all constantly mulling things over, working through things in our brain, on the subway, in a cafe, you know. The value of that and the value of living in a community where you are free and feel safe enough to like be able to kind of walk down the street and wander and think, like, that's so important. So how can these spaces maybe help contribute to those sort of feelings in the, like, in larger, in that actual neighborhood and then actually this map for creative development actually, like, in some ways expands to every single borough, hopefully. I just brought this up because I feel like we have been talking a lot about these, what matters most to us.
Something that I would love to see, which I think is a bit of an offshoot from the main focus of this research, but I think could be an interesting complement to it, is would love to see some sort of index of the spaces where work is being made and how long the current creative leaders of those spaces have been helm of those spaces, and specifically how that affects both the ages of the people making work in those spaces and how long people have been making work that have access to those spaces. I think that's going to be something, especially in the next 10, 20 years, as we go through this sort of insane evolution of like what is possible to be offered to artists in terms of space resources from the perspective of institutions or organizations, how that starts to affect the work that's being made and the artists that are being supported.
That's a great point. That sounds like a whole PhD project.
I was also thinking about how rapidly this conversation changes also, and that might be a challenge that you guys face. Just looking at the spaces on that previous chart, a lot of them don't, there's a number of them that don't exist anymore or that have become much less accessible for various reasons in the last several years in particular, so that somebody that was going to look for space today actually wouldn't be able to use that space. And also I think that this notion of proximity and what people value is also changing very rapidly because the locations where artists live in New York has been changing so rapidly in the last several years. And as that changes, like the pros and cons of different rehearsal locations also have been shifting quite a lot. Especially people are starting to move to New Jersey in much larger numbers, and so rehearsing in Brooklyn is no longer as convenient as it used to be 5 years ago. And that's definitely changed the way I think about where to schedule rehearsals, because if you have people coming from New Jersey, then a Manhattan location is suddenly a lot more important.
I think those are great points. I think, yeah, that is definitely one of the challenges that I think even just conducting this very preliminary survey, we hit upon. We did ask a question about what space, are there spaces that you used to access that you no longer access? And almost half, if not more than half, said absolutely, yes, there are. And then we asked them, and can you name those spaces? Can you tell us why? And that stuff started to get really tricky, which is why we didn't really talk about it here, because I had a hard time figuring out how to process it and visualize it to something that I think it just proves it needs much more. All those things need to be considered more fully. Someone else had their hand.
I did. I had an interesting experience recently with New House. It's a sort of a community of, you have to have a membership to participate, and they do cultural events, and there are a lot of things there, facilities, and the reason I mention this is there was a talk there recently that I really wanted to go to, but I'm not a member, and I had never even really thought about applying, but you have to pay for membership, and you have to have certain people have to refer you in to be a member, and it just seemed to me that they had access. It's just a strange conundrum. I was sort of sitting in the coffee area listening to people talking to each other, and it was really more commercial arts that I was hearing. It wasn't creative people who were activists or, and that's who's having access to these higher end speakers who are willing to come and do talks for them. And I just wonder if this is going to be an issue, bigger issue as the current political climate continues. You know, how can we talk about like anticipating the possibility of that happening, where activists might be closed, or people talking about difficult subjects might get closed out of opportunities, even as far as rehearsal spaces or presentation spaces. Like, what can we do as a group to protect ourselves?
Yeah, I think you hit on the fact that, you know, this survey does only survey Prelude artists, so we're all, it's a particular kind of work being developed, it's a particular process that people are using, kind of more or less. It's certainly not meant to be a comprehensive look at how all artistic activity, or even how all performance or time-based work is made. And I think, yeah, there are maybe, if you were to look at that, there may be a lot of resources that we just don't, that people don't have access to for different reasons, like the ones you're mentioning.
But I'm wondering if it's going to become...
If it's going to even narrow down more.
And if that's the reason why some of these spaces are no longer
definitely plays a role.
There's something funny about the network that is almost behind a lot of those organizations that are at least have a big, like they're showing up a lot in the word cloud, and the network of, you know, property managers and real estate developers and other sort of partners that make the space actually possible for the organization to then figure out how to give the up to the artist. And I think a lot about, like, I don't know what the research is. That's to me where it feels like this. The prize is like sort of when those relationships can exist for longer than 1 year, and when those relationships actually feel like mutually beneficial. And I don't know what the research is, but there's got to be something about like the value of creative work happening in, you know, non-arts spaces that plays into this and into the future, because, you know, as spaces are turned into condominiums, can we not still work in them? I mean, maybe, like, could some, I don't know, I think a lot about that. And I get out of the city and that becomes this dream-like scenario where suddenly huge town offices are available just by being like, is it okay? And I'm like, yeah, sure, it's okay. And I'm like, that's it, that's all. You know, like, these conversations that take years, I know, for you guys to develop, and then they don't even work that well sometimes. And anyway, I don't know if I have a real point on that.
Yeah, but what you said just really making me think that this would be a really interesting project to also undertake in a number of other differently sized cities that have a more kind of emerging, I mean, I would like to put Pittsburgh, for example, in that category. And to see the way in which people would answer this differently, and to see how that really impacts the kind of work that then gets produced, you know, to see the way in which this space, you know, to go back to something Maddie said, how does this space, like, that our work isn't dictating what space that we have, but the space that we can find dictates the work that we produce, and to really look at it on a much larger scale, and also to kind of look at it over a course of years. Like, it would be interesting to look right now in Pittsburgh and then do it in 5 years and 10 years and see how did it shift, and like to do this kind of in 5 years and to say, okay, how did it shift? How did that Google map change or something along those lines? So.
One more?
Yes, I mean, I think that it's sort of a little bit about what I was getting at earlier too. Like, we just don't have together to do that in a way that real estate and finance do. And I think also an interesting thing about the who responded, that there are so few inexperienced people that participate in the organization of this industry, because there was another study that was done by the Brooklyn Commune Project a couple of years ago that showed the absolute impractical dreamer nature of most graduates, that I think it was more than half of them responded to the survey that they fully expected that 100% of their salary to pay for their lives would come from their art making within 5 to 10 years. And then if you ask, and then in the same survey, the people that had been making work for 5 to 10 years, it was 4% were making enough money to survive. So people don't understand that that's part of the way an industry survives and thrives, especially in this city where it is very difficult to do something like this, because we exist in the vortex of real estate and finance, which study themselves intricately like this and don't have a big problem getting comprehensive data sets, because there's the Better Business Bureau and 900 other organizations whose explicit purpose is to do that so that they can continue to make more and more and more and more and more and more money. So long as we're this ship that's stuck in their sail on the runaway capitalist money train, we're not really going to be able to do studies like that. And I don't know what point we stop together, and maybe we produce a little bit less and spend some time figuring this stuff out so that in the long run it's better for everybody. It's not how we're trained as people, unfortunately. But I think that that's an important, I look to the arts sector to do that, and I was hoping the cultural plan was going to help us do that a little bit in a way that it did not really. But I wonder if there is a way, if somebody can get some funding to start thinking about 10 and 25 year arcs and narratives in this world, in our industry, because right now we're just unable to even understand ourselves to figure out what to do about anything. And I think that's a big part of our problem. How do we navigate being an industry floundering in the wake of larger industries in this big city, which is why it would be interesting to do it in smaller cities. You get more comprehensive response, maybe you get a clearer understanding of what needs to be happening in a larger city like here in Chicago.
That's great. I think also it makes me think that, like, you know, our resourcefulness and creativity as artists sometimes works against us in this. Like, we're just gonna make it happen. We're gonna make the work because we need to make the work. So we're gonna find the loopholes, we're gonna find the nooks and crannies, we're gonna make it happen. Because that, I think, for us is kind of easier than to kind of put pause on things and say, can we look at this globally? Can we get some research behind it? And you know, force others who are outside of our, just like two steps outside of our field or our, to actually look and listen to us and see the kind of the impact that we're having and what our needs are. So that's great. I think we're gonna wrap up, yeah? So thank you all so very much. I really enjoyed this conversation. I hope this was interesting and somehow fuels your moving through these networks. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Danielle. Hi, I'm Jose, I'm one of the associate researchers for Prelude. We're going to change over now to Jill's talk. If you'd like to have a step outside, we'll set up the space, it will be about 2 minutes, and we'll let everyone